Hello everyone, welcome to this video presentation brought to you by QuadJacks. My name is Philip Collins. I'm a 2011 WSOP main event November Niner. I got 5th place for $2.2 million. In this video, I'm going to teach you some basic tournament strategy for playing live poker this summer. I've spent the majority of my professional career playing tournaments, and I can't share everything that I have in this short video, but hopefully I'll give you a good amount of tips and some strategy and some things to consider for this summer, and hopefully you can have some success. Alright, let's get started. The first thing I'd like to talk about is the structures of the tournaments that you might be playing. The daily deep stack tournaments over at the Venetian or at the Rio, and now the new Carnival of Poker that they're going to have, or the WSOP preliminary events, all play a lot faster and have a much quicker structure than, say, the WPT 25K or the WSOP main event. It's important to know the difference between fast and slow structures and the reasons that it dictates how you should play. Whenever the stack sizes start to change, you have to adjust your style of play. In a fast structure, the stack sizes are going to get shallow, a lot shorter, a lot quicker. And in a slow structure, people will be able to accumulate lots of chips and you can play a lot more post-flop. It's very important that you are adjusting and thinking ahead towards different blind changes about how you want to be playing. Inflection points are when the blind changes are significant. Early in a tournament, when you're playing 50, 100, and the blinds increase to 100, 200, if everybody still has 20,000 in chips, the blind change didn't really affect your overall strategy. But at a point where you might be at 100, 200, in a few short levels, you could find yourself at 200, 400 with a 50 ante, and your style of play and the stack sizes should be much different. It's important to consider those things and be adjusting accordingly. One of the most important things to know in an Elo Hold'em tournament is when to go all in, especially pre-flop. Pre-flop strategy is absolutely critical in an ultimate hold'em tournament. It's the first decision that you are going to be making, and if you make an incorrect decision, it can lead to further errors down in a hand, or you could be eliminated in a quick swoop with one bad decision. Shoving and reshoving are the most critical aspects of a pre-flop strategy. You have to know when to go all in whenever your stack size gets shallow enough. When you have 15 big blinds in late position, you shouldn't be raising and folding your hands. You should just be going all in. And when you have 20 to 25 big blinds, if someone's raising, you shouldn't be calling very often. You should be raising all in. A big reason this is the case is because speculative hands are actually a lot of trouble. Calling raises with hands like 6-7 suited or 10-jack, whenever you have a medium or a shorter stack, will put you in a really awkward spot once you get post-flop. You can flop a small piece, maybe top pair, maybe second pair. Maybe you flop a straight draw, and you could quickly find yourself being priced out of a hand, having only seen one card the turn, and given away a quarter of your stack. The chips you save are worth more than the chips you gain. This is one of the most important tidbits that I hope you get from this video, especially when playing tournaments. Giving away chips with speculative hands is one of the biggest mistakes that amateur players make. It's very important that you're staying patient and waiting for a good spot sometimes to shove all in. Let's talk about some of the player types that you might be facing. One of the most important aspects of no limit hold'em is to play each opponent at the table individually. Not everyone plays the game the way you do. Maybe no one does. And hardly everyone at the table will all be playing the same style. It's very important that you are adjusting your style of play to the style of play of your opponents. There are a few basic types of player types. Aggressive versus passive. Tight versus loose. I'm sure you've heard the term loose aggressive or tight aggressive. It's very important that you are paying attention at the table. Very important to pay attention at the table and try to gauge what type of player you're facing. Some opponents that you face could be amateurs and some could be professionals. If you're at a table full of amateurs who are maybe tight and passive, this is an extremely good opportunity to play loose aggressive and go after building a stack. If you're at a table full of professionals, the best strategy might be to play tight and aggressive and make sure that you're not putting yourself in too many awkward spots. Another thing that's extremely important is to know yourself. Knowing your image and how you're perceived at the table is absolutely vital. Understanding how opponents are going to react to you is also extremely important. Pick your battles with the players that you feel you have the biggest advantages against. I'm sure you'll feel that you have a skill edge over a few players at your table, and it's likely that you might feel the exact opposite about a couple other players, or at a minimum, that you feel they're solid, tricky, or very capable of putting you in an awkward spot. Try to know your limitations, and don't put yourself in an awkward spot against a player that's better than you, or someone that you just don't understand. Protect the information about yourself. Don't give away what tournaments you've been playing, how much the buy-in of the tournament matters to you, whether you got in a satellite. Try to give away as little information as possible. At the same time, you should be listening to anything else that the other opponents at your table might be giving away. Your body language is also extremely important. Beware of your posture. If you're leaning in close to the table, it could be obvious that you're ready to pounce and looking to play pots. If you're sitting back relaxing, it can look like you're relaxing and don't have a desire to get in the pot with a marginal hand. Let's talk a little bit about live tells. Now, tells are only a small part of the game, but in live poker, information is vital, and picking up some sort of tell or information off of opponents' physical attributes can be very good for you. Try to use the same motions. One of the biggest tips I can give if you're worried about live tells is to be consistent in what you're doing. If you're going to check by tapping the table twice, tap the table twice every time. If you're going to use lots of little chips like 25s and 100s all the time, then make sure you continue to do it. Being consistent is something that's very easy that you can control, and being consistent is a good way to not give off live tells yourself. Beware of your table talk, like I said, but one of the easiest ways that opponents can give off tells is by the things that they're saying. They'll quickly tell you that they're a tight or loose player in a sentence or two, explaining how they played ace-king one time. Little tidbits of information can be extremely important to determining a player type early in a session and gaining a large advantage. The number one place to look, obviously, is the face. Touching the face, nose, or mouth is a sign of discomfort because it is comforting for a human to touch their face. If you see someone doing so, it could be because they're awkward. They're in an awkward spot, or they're uncomfortable. Look for face redness. Look for eyebrow furrowing if they're trying to be all serious. The mouth is probably the biggest part of the face tell that you can look for. If a person is sitting with a calm mouth and not breathing very heavily the majority of the hands they play, and then later you see them with their mouth open and breathing heavily, it can let you know that the range is becoming much more polarized. And if this player is tight, it'll quickly let you know that they're holding a big hand, if they're breathing heavy. And one of the easiest ways that you can look for a live tell is with the two major ones, pulse and breathing. A lot of times just by looking at a neck, you can see a person's pulse. The skin will be bumping up and down. It's extremely obvious. Sometimes the whole neck is pulsing and you can see a red neck, and it can be very obvious. And breathing, you can see it straight through a t-shirt if somebody starts to breathe heavily. It doesn't necessarily always mean that they're bluffing or that they have a big hand. Actually, I found it usually means they have a big hand, because different players act differently. But if you know a tight player usually has it, and then you see him breathing extremely heavily with a pounding pulse in his neck, he probably really, really has it. And then maybe you can throw away a marginal hand, like queens. One of the go-to live tell slogans is that strong is weak and weak is strong. If someone is acting strong, it could be because they're intimidating you and they want you to fold. And if someone is acting weak, it could be because they are strong and they want you to stay in the pot. You can see this most of the time through the way someone is putting their chips in the pot. If they're slamming them into the pot looking really strong, or if they're setting them into the pot gently, that can be a way. Or different body language tells, or things that they could be doing or saying that are trying to act strong or weak. Just a tidbit, something to always consider to help you while you're analyzing a hand. Now, a little Fildo special that I think is a great tell is what I call the cloak. It's usually an amateur or a weaker player, and it's called the cloak because they're trying to hold on to what I call an invisibility cloak. They're usually touching the chin or mouth with some sort of closed fist, maybe on the neck area, resting their face, and they're almost grasping at an invisible cloak that they're trying to wrap around them to hide the fact that they are holding a monster. I've seen this a lot of times, and a lot of amateur players get very tight, have a clenched fist around their neck, mouth area, and it looks like they're holding a cloak. If you see that and you spot them with a monster, let me know, because I think that one's a pretty good one. Check it out. All right, let's talk about some basic tips. So far, we've hit on three major keys: adjusting the style of your play to different stack sizes, the structure, and player types. Adjusting your style of play is absolutely critical. Changing gears is one of the best things that you can be doing in a no-limit hold'em tournament. You shouldn't necessarily be changing gears arbitrarily. Hopefully you are changing your gears to best exploit the table, because every hand is a new hand, and every decision is a new decision. As the stack sizes increase, you should be considering loosening your game. As the stack sizes decrease, you should be considering tightening your game. If the structure is going to be advancing quickly, it might be a time to pounce while the stacks are still at 40 or 50 big blinds, where you have time to maneuver. And if you're at a table full of weak players, it's very important that you try to accumulate as many chips as you can, because a couple of professionals seated on your left at the next table change could be disastrous for your possible success. As you're changing gears, it's important that you're constantly being aggressive. There are two ways to win a hand in no limit hold'em. You can have your opponent fold, or you can have the best hand at the end. By playing your hand passively, you are completely giving up the ability to win the hand by your opponent folding. If you are aggressive, it gives you both chances to win. Your opponent can fold and you can win the pot, or you can make the best hand by the end. While you're being aggressive, it's also extremely important to be patient. The two concepts are pretty much the opposite of each other, but the perfect blend of patience and aggression is what's required in a no-limit hold'em tournament. Being patient and avoiding tough spots against strong players is important, and being aggressive and making decisive actions in good spots or against weaker players is very important. A really simple tip is to attack from later position. If you're being patient and folding in marginal spots, you could easily find yourself on a spot where you can steal a couple of blinds right back by opening a weak hand. 5-6 suited, queen 4 off from the button or the cutoff. Anything could do, especially if you have a couple of weak opponents with marginal stack sizes, on your left, people who aren't really calling a lot of raises. It's very important to be controlling the pot size of the hands that you are playing. By not getting yourself in awkward spots pre-flop is the best way to control pot sizes. If you play a weak hand from early position, you can find yourself in an inflated pot with top pair and you don't know what to do. If you attack from later position, you are almost always going to be in position in the hand, having had one of the blinds call you, and it's much easier to control the size of the pot by checking behind, betting, and then seeing where you're at. Lots of different ways. Balancing in general, I find overrated. As you're adjusting your play to the stack sizes, the structures, and the player types around you, your ranges will inherently become balanced. But arbitrarily deciding to balance your range and make a move just to balance your range is not the way you should be approaching. Don't make moves just to make moves. If you shouldn't be bluffing a player and he's a total calling station, don't balance your range. Keep it completely polarized towards a value range. Balancing just because of the sake of it, because you feel like you have to, is a mistake I see young wannabe professionals making a lot. It's important that every single time you act, you understand that it's an opportunity to make the best decision. Always be willing to change the plan that you have going forward, and always be looking for as much information as you can through live tells, player talk, or as a turn or a river strikes, to change or make the best decision possible in any given instant. All right, let's talk about a hand that I played with Phil Ivey last year. It was his level one, or day one of the WSOP main event. I had a couple of good players at my table, Jake Balsiger, David Gray, Phil Ivey. Random number five was good as well. It folds to Phil Ivey. Sorry about that for a second. It folds to Phil Ivey in the cutoff, and he opens to 1100. And I have my first decision of the hand. Now, I hadn't really played very many hands versus Phil Ivey, and I had obviously been avoiding him. I had position on him. It was the second time I'd played with him. And that made my decision process a lot easier in every hand. If he was in it, I was trying to be out of it. And if he was out of it, then I'd look to play a hand and try to attack the weaker players at the table, obviously. He hadn't been winning very many pots, and I had him outchipped by about 3-2, with about 35,000 and him about 23,000. Since I hadn't played too many hands versus him, I was pretty sure that he would fold and give me a lot of credit for a big hand if I 3-bet with ace-king suited, a monster. So I decided the best thing that I could do in this instance, later in the day at 2-4, was to disguise my hand versus Phil Ivey and just call. I didn't think he would ever shove ace-queen, so raising and calling a shove from Phil would have been a recipe for disaster, just asking to get it all in versus a hand that has me dominated. And since each hand is a new opportunity to make the best decision, I decided to just call Phil Ivey with ace-king suited in position. On the flop came 10-4-2 rainbow. I decided that I definitely had to call another street. He was likely going to put me on a medium pair hand, and I could definitely win a lot of chips if I turned an ace or a king and he decided to keep barreling me. When he bet 1600, I made what I considered the easy call. The turn was a great card. It was a two of hearts. It gave me that backdoor nut flush draw, and I actually thought it was a good card for Phil to two barrel. If I have a 10 or 7s, 8s, or 9s, him putting another bet, a large bet into the pot, is what we call the turn hammer. It's going to put me in an awkward spot where I'm going to be facing a potential river bet as well, even though he's only betting the turn just now. As expected, Phil Ivey fired 4,000 into the pot. At this point, I probably think I have the best hand, but I also know that if I raise Phil Ivey all in, he has to be putting me on a giant hand here, probably aces or kings, at a minimum, ace 10 or king 10, and he'll be in a terrible spot if he has a hand like jack 10, 9 10, and I think there's no way that he can continue if I raise him. So I decide to make it 12,500 with the intention of calling if he goes all in, obviously. But fortunately, Ivy folds, and I'm able to win a really nice pot. A couple of things to consider here are how I adjusted my style of play based off of the opponent and stack size. But at the same time, I stuck to my basic strategy and wasn't afraid to play a hand that I knew I should be playing post-flop versus a good player. I had the benefit of position, and I decided to mix up my play in order to disguise my hand, one of the best reasons. I also successfully analyzed that if I raised all in, he'd most likely be in a terrible, terrible spot, and I didn't quiver under the pressure of busting the main event on a bluff or under the scrutiny of a Phil Ivey stare, and I went with my read, raised him, and won a good pot versus the greatest of all time. Alright, hope you guys enjoyed this video. Thank you for QuadJacks for hosting it for me, and if you see me around the summer, please say hey, let me know what you thought of the video, and good luck.